normal shocks. We talked, we developed various relations that will be there for normal shock. Then we started the discussion, what will happen if, let us say, the shock is not stationary. So far we have discussed that we have a tube and we have a stationary shock there. Fluid is approaching the shock and fluid is leaving the shock, but the shock remains stationary. But in many practical applications, actually most practical applications, you will see that shock is like this. Shock is basically attached to this, this is an aeroplane or any moving object, or the shock is actually moving the fluid. So whether the analysis that we have carried out so far for stationary shock is applicable, or we need to do some modification with the theory. And if we require to adjust the theory, what are the parameters that we need to adjust or change to account for shock motion? That is what we are going to explore now. So let me get a pointer. Okay. So moving shock basically is generated mostly by moving body. For example, your aeroplane is moving at supersonic speeds. Okay. So it creates disturbance which propagate throughout the field. So one example is that we saw in the last slide is aeroplane moving in air. There could be other examples. For example, we could have a tube and a piston is suddenly accelerated. So the shock may not be, you know, attached to the piston. It will be away from the piston, but it can still move through the flow field. So it is not necessary that the shock is attached like this. It could be detached also. I think someone is trying to join. Okay, some issue with Google there. People are not able to. Earlier you were able to automatically join, right? I did not need to give you permission. Today something is going on. I will check if some setting change has been done. Okay, fine. So this is one example. Another example is that we have a piston cylinder arrangement that we are going to discuss in a little while. Once you move it suddenly, then it creates a shock that travels along the tube. So let us first change this slide. So there are various examples of moving shock, okay, which creates disturbance throughout the flow field. That will move through the tube, let us say. And the motion of this disturbance related to the fluid is called wave motion. So let us focus on the piston cylinder example. So let me draw it here for convenience. So earlier what we had one tube where shock is standing and shock is stationary and fluid is approaching and moving away from the shock. That is the stationary shock that we have discussed so far. Now let me remove this and let me draw moving shock. So let us say I have a straight tube. To keep it simple, let us say area is constant and I have one piston at one side and suddenly it is moved, okay, at high velocities. So it will generate a shock wave, let us say, which is moving to the right at certain velocity. That will see what velocity, how to analyze. But just to understand the configuration, this is how it will look. Because of this piston motion, this shock wave is generated, which travels throughout the length of the tube. Okay, it will keep on moving. Now the motion of this disturbance, okay, related to the fluid is called wave motion. That is very obvious. And speed of propagation is termed as wave speed. So this will denote it by CS, that we'll see in the next slide. And because of these waves, various parts of the body interact with fluid and with each other. Okay, so here is the piston. It is a simple configuration piston. So how this piston interacts with the flow field, or if you want a complicated configuration, then you can look at this aeroplane, that how different parts are interacting with fluid, what shock pattern will give you what type of drag or lift. These are some of the application perspective of the moving shocks. Okay, generally what we have considered so far is stationary shock. So this is one dimensional motion. Okay, for now, or also for moving shock, let us limit to that. So we'll talk about one dimensional motion of shock wave in a tube of constant area. So this is the simplest possible configuration to begin with. To understand this, then we can apply to more complicated configurations. We will also go to oblique shocks and see how it behaves. Okay, so let us begin with this simple example. So just to compare, I have also shown stationary shock, what we have been studying for quite some time now. So here the fluid is stationary and it should be shock. Let me just correct it. The shock is, we're getting at speed V1. Okay. Okay. So here the fluid is stationary and, sorry, shock is stationary here and fluid is coming at V1 and leaving at V2. That is what we studied for stationary shock. Now I want to study moving shock. So what I can do is I can assume that this fluid is stationary. Okay, this is not coming to the shock, but this is lying stationary. Now the shock moves. Okay, so what is the velocity of the shock? Shock will move at the same speed or same velocity in the opposite direction, and that is V1, right? So if the shock is stationary, fluid is coming at V1. If the fluid is stationary, then the shock will go at the same speed V1 into the fluid. Is this clear? People are connected or not?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So now look at moving shock. So as I mentioned, if I assume that this fluid is stationary, fluid lying ahead of the shock is stationary and shock is moving at CS. So what will be the CS equal to what? V1 or V2? Just now I have told. CS will be equal to?
V1.
V1. Numerical value will be equal to V1. Direction will be opposite. So CS is equal to V1 and VP is the piston speed. Okay. So let us say, what is the square V2? So V1 minus V2 will give you VP. Okay. So VP is the speed of the piston. Now tell me which one will be higher, VP or CS? Which is moving faster, piston or shock?
Shock.
So CS will be higher than VP. So for a stationary shock, V1 is the velocity of fluid that is ahead of shock wave related to the wind. This is coming towards the shock and this is behind the shock. Okay. Now for this, for a stationary shock, these are the equations that we have derived previously. We have looked into, this is continuity equation or conservation of mass, conservation of momentum, and this is energy equation. So this all we have derived for stationary shock. Now we will modify these equations and apply it to moving shock. So these equations hold for flow velocity related to shock wave, whether the shock is stationary or moving. So this form should be also be applicable for moving shock, but we'll make some adjustments based on our notation for velocity. So let's see what we do. So for a moving shock, we have CS is equal to V1 and VP is equal to V1 minus V2. So CS is the velocity of the shock wave related to the wave, and CS minus VP is basically V2, what we have in the last slide. So let us also look how these waves travel. So assume that the fluid behind the shock is followed by, this is what we are assuming, that a piston is coming, that is coming at VP. Okay, VP is V1 minus V2. And at time t it starts, it suddenly starts impulsively. This is important. And its speed is VP. It is not like slowly from zero it is coming, it is suddenly impulsively started with VP. Because of this impulsive motion, it will generate a shock, okay, which is running at CS. CS is the speed of the shock, and pressure on the piston face, here I assume that the pressure is P2. And this is the compressed region. Draw it for you. So the region between the piston and the wave. Understand, the piston is pushing the fluid to the right, and this is the shock front. So we have, after this, for example, in this region the fluid has no idea that piston is moving or not. So the effect of piston motion is felt in this region. That is the called the region of compression, compressed fluid. Okay. And this, the length of this region, okay, because CS is more than VP, so the length increases at the rate CS minus VP, right? And this is how the path will look like. So this x-axis shows time, y-axis shows time, and x-axis shows the distance. If you take this distance as x, so as you see, piston is moving slower. So this is the piston path. And shock is moving at higher speed. So shock will, for the same time, for example, here shock is at location 1 and piston is at location 2. Okay, so shock is moving faster, this is moving slower. That's one is shown in this plot, XT plot. Okay, so let us now talk about the equations. So for a stationary shock, this is what we have derived. Now I want to transform this equation for moving shock for this example. So what I will do is, I will use this change. I will say that instead of V1, here I will write CS. And wherever we have V2, for example, here I will write, instead of V2, I will write V1 minus, V2 will be VP minus, V1 minus VP. Right?
CS minus VP.
Wait. What we had in the last slide? V2 will be V1 minus V2. This is VP. So V2 will be V1 minus VP. So for example, V1 is going to the left, and then V2 is also moving that side, where the shock is stationary. Now the shock is moving towards right with a speed CS, right? So it will be CS is equal to V1, CS minus V2. So I can write V1 minus V2. That is piston speed. That's what we are substituting here. V2 is equal to V1 minus V2. You can write, instead of V1, you can write CS also, but this is what it makes, it will be the same, right? Is it okay? Why VP is V1 minus V2?
Yes.
Okay. Now, if you substitute that, you'll get rho 1 V1 will become rho 1 CS, and V2 is CS minus VP. You can write CS, you can write V1, whatever is convenient. Okay. Basically, it will depend on how the question is framed. So you can accordingly modify. So these are the same relations, just little bit of tweaking based on this relation. Okay, so here, for example, V1 is replaced by CS, VP is replaced by CS minus VP, again CS minus VP for V2, and for V1 I am having CS, that's all. So these are the relations for moving shock. Okay, continuity, momentum, and energy equation. Now, this is what we had in the last slide. This is coming from continuity equation, right? Now let us examine this more closely, or we'll do some rearrangement. So using this, I can write CS minus VP, take this to the other side, we'll have CS into density ratio, rho 1 by rho 2. Similarly for momentum equation, okay, if you do rearrangement, or rho 1, P1 plus rho 1 CS square will be remaining same. V2 is here. So the last term, CS minus VP. So instead of writing CS minus VP, I can substitute this term from here. CS minus VP is CS into rho 1 by rho 2. So that will become square. Okay. So I can say, if you take this P2, P1, P1 and P2 together, you can say delta p is equal to rho 1 cs square. This will come to the RHS and 1 minus this rho 1 by rho 2. Okay. Moving on, I can say just multiply all this and take cs one side. So cs will be delta p by density. This is rho 1 into basically this term only into rho 1. Okay. So again, just do some rearrangement, it will look like this. Delta p, and you take rho 2 as common, keep it in the numerator, and rho 1 will be the denominator. It will become rho 2 minus rho 1. That is what we have here. So finally, we have obtained a value for cs square. Okay, what I am trying to do here is that we will use these equations what we have derived for a moving shock, and with this manipulations we will show that same thing is coming for stationary shock. So just to like take a closer look or explain it more. So this is what we had in the last slide. Cs minus Vp is this much coming from continuity equation. I can also write Cs is equal to just take the Vp on the LHS. Okay, so Cs square is this much. This also we have obtained from the last slide. And if you do substitute the value of Cs minus Vp from here, we can Cs from here, we can obtain this relation. Okay, now you can take this density to the RHS. This will get cancelled. This some terms will get cancelled. And finally, we have this Cs minus Vp square is equal to dependent on pressure and density values. Now let us come to the last energy equation that we have derived for moving shock. So in this equation, if I substitute H, instead of H, I can write H can be represented as E plus P by rho. Okay, so H is basically U plus PV. Instead of U, I will write E, and instead of V, I will write 1 by rho. V is equal to 1 by rho, right? So this is for the first term enthalpy. Now let us see what can we do for Cs. For Cs, we have derived this relation that we can substitute here. And similarly, for Cs minus Vp also, we have derived a relation which looks like this, right, in the last slide. So take this equation and just replace all these terms with the given equations, right? So if I substitute all of three here, in this I will get energy equation in this form. Okay, this is nothing is complicated. I'm just replacing this term by this, that's all. For example, H, you know, H1 is here. So if I replace H by this, I will have E1 plus P1 by rho 1. What is what we have here? E1 plus P1 by rho 1. Similarly, Cs square is P2 minus P1, P2 minus P1, rho 2 minus rho 1, rho 2 minus rho 1, and rho 2 by rho 1. And half is coming from here. The same thing has been done in the RHS where Cs minus Vp is replaced in this term. That's all. Now, if you again do rearrangement, a lot of terms will get cancelled. For example, this is half and half. That will get cancelled. And you will be left with E1 minus E2. Take the E term on one side and P term on the other side. So you'll have E2 minus E1 is equal to, this is the average pressure, P1 plus P2, and 1 minus rho 1 minus 1 minus 1 by rho 2. Okay. Now, if you look closely, isn't it the same equation that we have derived previously for stationary shock? This is exactly what we had for stationary shock. If you replace rho by V, rho is equal to 1 by V. If you replace by that, this will turn out to be the same, right? So which shows that this is the Hugonet equation. So Hugonet equation for moving and stationary shock are the same because they are talking about the same physical phenomena. Okay. And Hugonet equation relates to change of thermodynamic variables across normal shock. Okay. So they do not bother whether the shock is moving or the shock is stationary. The physics is same. especially when you're talking about Kubernetes question, it says that we are concerned with flow passing through a shock. I don't worry whether the shock is stationary or moving. Okay. So this is the Kubernetes equation that we have in the last slide. Now, in this equation, if I replace E by CVT and we know that this is RT by T using from equation of state. So we can find the temperature ratio. Temperature ratio will be equal to P2 by P1 and this is what you will get. Just you have to replace E as CVT. We will be again right in terms of gamma and R will get cancelled from here. So you will end up with this. This is a simple equation. That's all. And also get, since you know temperature ratio, can also derive density ratio using the equation of state. This will be again shown in terms of gamma and T. So what do you see here? So what we can observe or what can summarize from this equation is that temperature and density ratios, they depend on pressure and gamma. Gamma, let us say, is constant for air. Generally, we take examples for air at normal temperatures. So it is a function, basically a function of pressure ratio, right? Now for a stationary shock wave, if you recall what when we have discussed the we are basically concerned with M1. We are trying to derive all the relations or all the equations in terms of back. Okay. So for a stationary shock, although stationary moving shock are physically similar or same, they are not very different. But when we talk about equations or relations, generally we consider M1 to be the governing parameter. Okay. When we talked about stationary shock, if you go back and revisit those slides, you will see that all the equations or formulas we are deriving in terms of M1. But for a moving shock, pressure ratio becomes a basic parameter. Okay, so we generally try to reduce our equations in terms of pressure ratio. Although the physics is same, but it becomes convenient when you basically when we look at numericals, then it will be more clear. But it is just based on convenience. Okay, we see that M1 is the governing parameter for stationary shock and pressure ratio is the basic or governing parameter for moving shock. Okay, we'll explore this more in next slides and basically once you look at numericals, it will become more clear. Okay, now for a moving shock, again, how do we define a Mach number? So let us say this is MS. So I can say that MS can be defined as CS is the wave speed, but we have seen that the shock is moving at CS and A1 is the velocity of sound in that medium. Where A1 square is dp by dTo for condition 1. Okay, we have two different fluid zones. One is behind the shock, which is denoted by 2, and one is ahead of the shock, that is denoted by 1. So that is the one I'm talking about. And this is the relation we had for pressure ratio. Okay. This is for stationary shock. Now if I derive the same for, basically I'm trying to derive relation for MS, for moving shock. This is how it will look. Basically you take these terms to the LHS and take a square root to find M1. So MS is CS by A1. Hence, I can write CS as A1 into, basically take this equation and multiply this term by A1. So you'll have CS. So CS or the wave speed, I can relate in terms of A1, which is known from the fluid properties at 1, gamma and pressure ratio. So as you can see, when we say that a normal shock is moving in a tube, I only need to know the conditions which are ahead of the shock and pressure ratio. So based on that, I can determine at what speed the shock is moving into the fluid. Okay. So it relates, basically this equation, it relates the wave velocity of a moving shock to the pressure ratio across the wave and speed of sound in the gas into basically what I just said. Okay, so this also we had seen, Vp is the piston speed is V1 minus V2 is equal to this. Now let us apply from where this is coming. This is coming from continuity equation. If I substitute it here, I can write Vp as Cs into, instead of V1, V2 by V1, I can write rho 1, rho 2. So Vp becomes this. Now let us use this last slide we have obtained relation for Cs, right? So in this, just use this and multiply with this bracket, we'll obtain ratio for rho 1 and rho 2. Okay, sorry, rho 1 and rho 2 are also we have seen in the previous slide. Cs is what we have seen in the last slide. So if you use both of them, you will obtain a relation for Vp, or basically what is the piston speed depending on what is the pressure ratio obtained. Okay, so like the shock velocity Cs, fluid velocity behind the shock, this is a mass motion velocity, basically piston velocity. It also depends on pressure ratio. Okay, so basically let us say that you are given a problem that this is the piston, this is the, you have a straight tube and this is the pressure ratio you are required to generate. So the piston speed cannot be arbitrary. You need to have your piston moving at this speed to generate this pressure ratio. So all these things are linked. It cannot be like you can move a piston with any arbitrary speed and you can generate any shock moving at any arbitrary speed. Everything, whether it is a speed of shock, the speed at which the shock is moving or speed at which the piston is moving, both of them will be determined based on your fluid properties and what is the pressure ratio you require. What is the pressure ratio you require, or if you know the value of this, then your pressure ratio becomes fixed. Okay. Now let us talk about weak and strong shocks. So weak shock, as we have also previously discussed once, so where your pressure jump is very small, okay, which is, let us say, delta P is tending to zero, or this is much, much lesser than one. Delta P by P1 is much, much lesser than one. This denotes a weak shock. So for such a case, you can use the temperature ratios what we have obtained for normal shock, and we'll approximate it for delta P very small. So this is what we'll get. This is the delta T, delta rho, and Cs. All this is for assuming that the delta P is very small and this is a weak shock case. Okay, I'm not going into the detailed derivation. Basically, we expand the terms in the bracket and we neglect higher order terms. Hence, we get this type of relation. So we'll say that delta P square will be zero. So those terms will be removed and you're having the first term of an expansion. So that will give you delta T and delta rho, and similarly for Cs. So what you see from here, if let us say delta P is very small, what can be said about Cs? Anyone wants to comment on that? So can I say that Cs is almost equal to A1? If this is very small, then this whole terms becomes small, or let us say negligible. In that case, I will say Cs is A1 into 1, which is almost A1, right? Moving on, let us talk about strong shock. So where your pressure ratio is large, then it is called strong shock. Okay. And we can also say that the strong shock is that with large upstream Mach number. So Mach number will also be large. That this term we used for stationary shocks, where we have a fluid coming at very high velocity or very high Mach number, then shock becomes strong. or delta p becomes very large. So for this approximation, let us say delta p is approaching a very large value, we'll get, these are the ratios that we'll obtain for this particular limitation. For delta temperature ratio, density ratio, CS and VP. These are all coming for strong shock. So what do we conclude from this last two slides? That for a strong shock, speed of shock CS and VP, this all, everything large. As you see, we are saying that P2 by P1 is very large. So hence, this ratio is directly proportional to P2 by P1. So if P2 by P1 is very large, this will also be very large. This will also be very large. And this will also be very large. But interestingly, density ratio has no dependence on P2 by P1. So that will be limited. Okay. For this limit, this will go to this value. This will approach this value, which is basically, if you take 1.4, gamma is equal to 1.4, it is not a very large value, right? So that is what we are highlighting here. So even when the Mach number tends to infinity, all these parameters, these all temperature ratio and shock speed, piston speed, all these tend to infinity, right? If P2 by P1 is infinity, this will become infinity because this is directly proportional. If this is infinity, CS is infinity and VP is also infinity, but it has no term of P2 by P1, so it will not approach infinity, but it will approach this value even when M1 is infinity. Okay, and if you substitute gamma is equal to 1.4, it will become 6. So this is a very surprising or very peculiar behavior, that other ratios are approaching infinity, but density ratio is approaching 6. For gamma, you take the value of air, it will become 6, even when M1 is approaching infinity. Okay, so this is an important behavior we must understand or take a note of, that the range of density is very small. Okay, the density ratio can go from 0 to 6. 6 for when it is approaching infinity, and other extreme could be when the density ratio is rho 1 is very small. Rho 1 is, let us say, almost rho 2 is very small. Rho 2 is, if let us say rho 2 approaches 0, then we have 0, and when M1 approaches infinity, I have maximum of density ratio is 6. So this is the parameter which plays dominant role. Okay, because the range is very small, it plays a dominant role over pressure and temperature ratios. Okay, so when you talk about practical applications, or you look at the actual numbers in a numerical, you will appreciate that density ratio, because it has a smaller range, the value of density ratio will determine how the flow behaves. Okay. Now, another important consideration that we must keep in mind whenever we are talking about weak shock or strong shock. So whatever we have discussed so far in this course, we have assumed that the fluid is continuum hypothesis is applicable. Okay, how do we check or how do we verify or confirm that continuum is applicable? So there is a number called Knudsen number. Okay, it is the ratio of mean free path and length scale. So we see what is the value of this number, and if this is less than 0.01, what it means? If it is less than 0.01, it means that the mean free path of molecules or atoms, it is like 100 times more than the length scale of the object that we are studying. Okay, for that case, we can say that continuum hypothesis is valid and whatever we have studied so far is applicable. Now beyond that, if you go for very rarefied gas or where your length basically ratio is very small, then this hypothesis will not be valid, and there are different approaches. How do we understand that? One of them is rarefied gas. So beyond the scope of the present syllabus, we'll not talk about that. So whatever problems we'll encounter, we will make sure that Knudsen number is less than 0.01 and continuum hypothesis is valid. So that is the one of the basic assumptions for this subject. Please be clear with that. So for example, if you go for let us say we talk about a rocket launch in upper atmosphere or near vacuum regions. So for those conditions, we will talk about rarefied gas dynamics. We will not talk about compressible flow or gas dynamics, gas dynamics, what we are studied so far. Okay, moving on. Let us now talk about reflected shock wave. So till now what we have assumed, we said that there is a tube in which shock is moving or shock is stationary. So we assume that the tube is infinitely long for our purpose and we do not bother about the end region. Now let us say that shock is moving in a tube where the tube is of finite length and this wall is closed. Okay, this is not open, this is closed. So what will happen? Shock will come, it will hit the tube, end wall, and it will get reflected. So this is called reflected shock wave. Okay, we will see also in other examples. For example, flow in a CD nozzle, there are a lot of examples where shock waves are reflected. So this is one of the simplest configurations to understand and to derive the basic Govani relations. This is what we are going to focus on. So what is that once this shock is reflected, let us say initially it is going at a speed CS, now it is coming back at speed CR. Okay, so the strength of this reflected shock is such that Vp is basically, it assumes that originally induced mass motion with velocity Vp is stopped completely in its track. So let us say there is no motion behind that. So CR basically balances Vp. Okay. So what happens is that this V5 becomes zero behind the shock because this has not now started to reflect. So beyond that, it becomes zero. Initially, it was also zero. Initially, we are assuming that the shock is moving in a stationary fluid. Fluid is stationary, shock is moving. So this is zero, V1 is zero. Now, for reflection, we consider a state 5. So 5, V5 is zero. Okay. And the zero velocity boundary condition is kept by the reflected shock wave. So that is also maintained. Moving on, you people are connected or not? I am not able to hear anything.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, I'm fine.
Yes, sir.
Please keep talking, otherwise, of mention or something. Yes. Oh, please feel free to stop. Now, let us talk about reflected shock. So, first focus on this figure. Basically, what happens? We will also study about shock tube. So in a shock tube, what we basically do is we have a high pressure region where we fill gas at high pressures and other section is at low pressure. So in a shock tube, what we do is we have a diaphragm which we open at some time. Basically, it is broken by some external force. Once we break this diaphragm, or ideally, let us say that we remove the partition that is there. So once we remove the partition, what will happen? High pressure fluid will try to go move here in a low pressure region. Okay. So it will move at certain velocity CS. The wave will move at CS, fluid will move at VP. Let us say that there is an imaginary piston which is pushing that. So that piston will move at VP. Now, you imagine this boundary. So this boundary is suddenly removed. Now, right side, it will receive gas. Okay, let me draw it. So because gases are moving from left to right, so this region will receive more and more gas, and basically it is one wave is shock wave is created which is moving towards the right. Now what about the left section, high pressure region? What will happen to that? So initially it has small region, but it is at high pressure. Now that pressure is removed, or you can also imagine that earlier I had a lot of gases stored here. Now that gases are suddenly removed from here. That gases are basically moving to the right. So it suddenly sees a drop in pressure. So that drop is visible here. Okay. So this is a expansion region. One right side we have a shock which is moving towards the right, and here we have an expansion region that is moving towards the left. That we'll study moving on. But this is the basically what happens. And this shock, it will go towards the end wall. It will hit the end wall, and you will see a reflected shock coming that will interact with the incoming fluid and all that. So lot of interesting physics is going on. We'll try to understand one by one. So let us look this process in a XT diagram. So this is time. I think I have, this part is missing. This is time. So let us say this is your incident shock CS. Okay, it starts at X1. So this is moving with time. It is moving towards the right. It is X is increasing, or it is moving towards the right. It reaches up to 2. Okay, this is your 2. So at time t is equal to 0, it is here. T is equal to 1, it is at x1. Okay, let us say at t is equal to 1, it reaches x1. And then it keeps on moving with the same velocity, cs. Okay, and it reaches 2. 2 is the where it hits the wall. Now we have a reflected wave which is moving backwards. Backward means as your time is increasing, x is decreasing, right? So it is moving back. So at some point, let us say at this location, this is moving back at time t3. This is the x. This is the x location where it is located. And this slope is given by CR. CR is the speed of reflected shock, which is coming back. Okay. Now let us look at these comments. So what is the slope? Slope is given by the velocity or speed. This is xt, distance and time plot. So slope will be given by velocity. So slope of the incident and reflected shock are 1 by cs and 1 by cr. So if I have plotted x in y axis, distance in y axis and time in this axis, then the slope will be c, velocity. But because I have plotted distance in x-axis and time in this axis, so that slope becomes reverse. So I have slope of 1 by cs and 1 by cr. As we have discussed in the last slide, that cs, which is the speed of the incident shock, that will be higher than cr. Okay, reflected shock will be having lesser velocity. Because of that, these two slopes will also be different, right? So the reflected shock path is steeply, more steeply inclined. So it just comes from the fact that CS is more than CR. That's why the slope are also 1 by CS and 1 by CR are also similarly related. That's all. So now let us try to derive relations for that. So again, this we have already discussed, that CR plus Vp is the velocity of the gas ahead of shockwave related to the wave. Let me see if I have a figure here. Okay. And CR is the velocity of the gas behind shockwave related to the wave. Okay, so that is how we define our variables to understand the reflected shock behavior. So let us say, let us start with the first derivation we did for stationary shock, and these equations will modify to find out relations for reflected shock. Okay, so this I assume that everyone is clear with: continuity, momentum and energy equations. Now what do I substitute? I will say that V1 becomes CR plus Vp. Okay, this is the velocity of gas ahead of shock wave relative to the wave. That is what we have defined V1 for stationary shock. Similarly, V2 is the velocity behind the shock. Basically, what we used V2 for. The same thing will use CR, perfected wave. So if I substitute these two in these given relations, we'll obtain relation for reflected shock. So again, similarly, we are just replacing V1 by this and V2 by CR. One important change is that we are trying to relate to state 2 and state 5. If you look at this plot, let me delete it once. Okay, we have not marked here, but see there this state where you are talking about reflected shock that we refer to as 5, I think in the last slide we have. Yes. So we are trying to relate state 2 and state 5. Okay, let us talk in this state 2 and state 5. We are not worried about 1, 3 and 4. 3 and 4 would be very near to the shock that we'll see later, but we are talking about upstream and downstream condition for a reflected shock, which are denoted by 2 and 5. That is what you see in this relation. We are talking about rho 2 and rho 5. Similarly here, all the variables are for 5, so P5, rho 5, H5, and likewise. So these are the relations for reflected shock derived using stationary shock relation and this assumption. Okay. So now we can say that incident shock, shock which is coming towards the wall, it is going with a speed of ms, which is cs by a1. This already we have seen. This is the general behavior for moving shock. Now let us see what happens to the reflected shock. So it propagates with the speed cr plus vp by a2. Okay, it is moving into a2 and with this speed. So this is the general relation which we can derive for reflected shock, Mach number of reflected shock. Okay, we'll talk a little bit more about it when we go to numericals. But this is how MR and MS are dependent on each other. You see, MR is the Mach number for the reflected shock and MS is what we have for incident shock. So this is how these two are related. Okay. Now, one interesting thing that we have seen here that we have not discussed much. So there is an expansion region. Okay, basically it is like a low pressure region is moving into a high pressure region. How these two mingle or mix? So to study that, we need to understand expansion wave. Okay, so it is like instead of pushing a piston into the fluid, it is similar to like I'm pushing the piston back. Okay. Hence, let me draw it for you once. So, for example, if I want to generate a shock, what will I do is, I have a tube with a piston. I'll move the tube piston forward. So, a shock wave will be generated, right? This is what we have studied for moving shock. Now, instead of moving the piston forward, I will, let us say, push it backwards. So, this region suddenly expands, okay, and especially if let us say it is closed, then suddenly the pressure will drop. So for that type of example or that type of configuration, we see centered expansion wave. This is basically, you can imagine to be opposite of shock. Shock is basically a compression wave. It compresses the fluid ahead of it. Expansion wave is where you are seeing expansion. The gas mass is constant and you suddenly see the pressure is, volume is increasing, pressure is decreasing. So you see expansion wave. Okay. Now the front of the expansion wave travels with the speed of A4 into undisturbed fluid and direction opposite to the piston and fluid motion. Okay, let us say I have a long tube, I have a piston here. If I move the piston forward, the shock wave will be generated here, it will move this direction, right? Now if I have expansion wave, basically I am moving this piston out. I am suddenly withdrawing it. So this wave which is emitted near the piston, now it will move away from the piston. Okay, that's why it said that direction opposite to the piston and fluid motion. And this is assumed to be generally, we say that this is an isentropic wave. So if you talk or if you assume it to be isentropic, you can say that it travels with the speed of sound, right? For example, Mach waves, it travels with the speed of sound. So this is what is happening. So you see, one piston is here, piston is suddenly moved backwards. Now, so far we had outside, let us say, the in this region, earlier we had P4, which is at a higher pressure, but because piston has moved back, so the pressure is decreasing to P3. Okay, and what is the velocity? So here, undisturbed fluid, velocity is zero, which is undisturbed at T1, but here, velocity is negative, some fluid is moving back, right? To fill the gap, piston has created a void here. To fill that, some fluid is moving back. Is this clear to everyone? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I think we are running out of time. So let us stop here. This again, I will start in the next class. We have a few slides for expansion fan. So that I will try to cover up. I also want